What? I'm not, I replied, trailing off. I slowly backed away from her, touching the skin on my face. It might have just been my imagination, but it almost felt waxy, like the skin of the creatures. What's happening to me? What's going on? Jay said it takes 12 hours to convert, didn't he? You'll be fine until then, she said, but her voice wasn't very convincing. Even less convincing was the hand that slowly made its way down to her hip, where it rested, mere inches from her gun. I'll go get him and tell him. I nodded, pacing back and forth nervously. I didn't feel any different, as I would have expected someone suffering from a mind-altering virus to feel. The only thing was the paranoia that now set in. Would the creatures still attack me, or would they accept me as one of their own? The darkness was suffocating. It surrounded me, and it felt like I couldn't breathe. I was disorientated entirely and panicking. What could I do? What was there to do? If I allow myself to become one of those creatures, would I kill Scarlet? The seconds until she arrived back with Jace felt like hours, but she finally did, and she explained the situation. Well, he's definitely not contagious, so you don't have to worry about being near him, at least for now, Jace said, but there's not much else I can put in a positive light. We have no idea what cure might look like, and even if we did, there'd be no way to make it until we somehow had all the ingredients here in this building. God, how could I have forgotten about the eyes? When did I get it? I asked, and how come Scarlet doesn't have it? Did you ever smell something really pungent, something that smelled so bad it almost made you throw up? Jace returned my question with one of his own. Probably around the testing chamber, if you made it that far. Yeah, right when we walked in, I replied, recalling the smell. It faded after a bit, though. What happened? That's it, Jace said grimly. The virus has a distinct smell, and once you smell it, there's some time to escape, but if you adjust to the smell by that time, it'll already have gotten inside you. How come Scarlet didn't get it? I asked. Did all the viruses go into me? Jace glanced at Scarlet without saying anything for a moment, then he gasped. Wait, did you smell it? He asked. No, why, she replied. Jace leaped up into the air with a shout, pumping his fists. Thank you, Jesus, he exclaimed. There's hope. What? She asked excitedly. What is it? You're immune, he replied, grabbing her by the shoulders. When the scientists were studying it, they of course accounted for immunity. They said something about how the scent of the virus is so impactful that an early sign of immunity might be an inability to sense it. That him getting affected and you not is highly likely that you have some form of immunity. Really? She asked, her eyes widening. That's incredible. Can we use this to help Dexter? Jace let out a long exhale. There may be a way. It'll be hard. And if it were just for you, I wouldn't do it. So generous, Scarlet muttered. That sounds harsh, sorry, he apologized. But it involves us taking back the corporate offices, and that means getting out. What's in the corporate offices, I asked. The head scientist. She actually wasn't with Rhino completely, but Rhino took her by force in the event that the scientist was needed. Her name is Julia Russell, and she had access to early tests of cures. None of them were successful, but given the proper antibodies, I was told they may have worked. So the antibodies might be in my blood, Scarlet clarified, and he nodded. But we're against the clock. We have probably 8-9 hours before it's too late, said Jace. The cure works once Dexter already turned. I don't suppose you have a plan, do you? I asked, and for the first time, a smile crept across his face. I was hoping you'd ask, he said. March 21st. The plan was relatively simple in theory. Scarlet and I would crawl into the upper floors through the ceiling, then I'd search for the scientist and she'd activate the elevator, allowing reinforcements to follow in case we met resistance. Once we had the scientist, he'd aid us with the serum, and after adding Scarlet's blood, I'd be cured. And then we could make contact with the FBI and hopefully make it out of this wretched place. We spent the last half an hour or so going over the floor plans, as blueprints of all floors and the ventilation system were accessible from the offices we had access to. Now we're just about ready to go. How does it feel? Scarlet asked as we sat in one of the offices beneath the floor tile we'd eventually climb through. I don't know, I replied. It's mostly normal, but sometimes I feel something inside of me. It might just be me thinking about it too much, but it feels like it's rising up, and if I don't push it down, it'd take over. She nodded, not replying verbally. I had begun to relax about it all. I knew I was on the verge of getting the cure, and not a lot could go wrong from this point on. Jason told us that Rhino's pistol was the only weapon up there, and one man with a pistol would be no match for us. We'd been trained numerous times for this specific scenario, and knowing the exact floor plan certainly wouldn't hurt our cause. It was about 5 minutes before Jace came back once more. He knocked on the door as he entered and said, "We're ready when you are. How are you holding up?" I knew the question was directed to me. While I haven't felt hunger for human flesh yet, other than that, I'm perfectly fine. I saw the corners of his mouth turn up in the darkness, and he said, "It's good to keep your humor. It helps retain humanity. Well, you're good to go whenever. You know the way." And with that, he returned to wait with the team he selected to aid us in the mission. He wasn't one to mince words. He said what needed to be said and nothing more. I'd only known him that day, and even I could tell that. I pushed myself off the table I'd been leaning against and said, "We might as well get going. There's no time like the present." Scarlet was equally ready, at least externally. "Agreed," she replied, and we began the cumbersome process of entering the ventilation shaft above our head. A ladder had been produced from some supply closet, but the hardest part wasn't getting there. It was distributing my weight sufficiently that I wouldn't collapse half the system simply by hanging for a moment too long. It took the two of us about 5 minutes to get up, but we did so without disaster, and then the undoubtedly cumbersome process of slowly shuffling our way through the cramped metal space was underway. We'd memorized the directions to get where we needed to go, but there was still the possibility of missing a turn or forgetting a drop was ahead, so we crawled in utter silence, focused entirely on the task at hand. I was brimming with confidence as we neared our final destination, the final trail we had to surmount before entering the upper floors was a difficult one. However, a 20-foot vertical shaft that we would have to climb using nothing but the force of friction. I arrived at the wall earlier than I expected, my hands brushing against the back wall a few steps before I'd anticipated. "We're here," I hissed back to Scarlet to avoid an unwanted collision. "All right, don't fall on me," she whispered back. "It'd be a shame to have to survive a zombie attack only to be killed by a clumsy partner." "Whatever," I said, rolling my eyes in the darkness as a smile spread across my face. I felt the air above my head to make sure I wasn't going to bump into anything and stood. For a moment, I just stretched my legs, adjusting to standing, and then I prepared for the ascent. I considered for a moment sticking my flashlight in my mouth just to provide some sense of security, but decided I wouldn't need it. Like the rest of the vents, I had the vertical shaft entirely memorized. I positioned my hands on either side of my body, pressing them against the walls of the shaft to test its skiv. When I was ready, I pushed off, lifting my feet off the ground and beginning the climb. It was a strenuous effort, inching my way up minute by grueling minute. By the time I was halfway up, my arms and legs, my torso, it all ached. But I didn't falter. I knew a lot rode on my shoulders. But I also knew I was more than up to the task. So I remained calm and collected as I shuffled my way to the upper echelons of the building. 20 feet may not seem terribly high, but using the method of travel I was, it took a considerable amount of time to traverse the distance, and the clanking sound of what I could only assume was the ventilation system shifting only made it feel longer. I did reach the top when my hand finally felt the ledge. I let out a sigh of relief, confident as I'd been. There was always the chance that something could go horribly wrong, and I was glad it hadn't. Then it did. A shriek, like the one that came out of the testing room, emanated from the darkness, and a hand soon followed. It latched onto my hand, attempting to pry my grip from the ledge, and it nearly succeeded. However, I managed to grab on with my other hand at the last moment, saving myself and Scarlet from a very painful drop. "What is it?" she called as I grunted, struggling to pull myself up before the creature could impede my progress further. Unwilling to spare effort for a response, I quickly lowered myself a small amount, then instantly pulled back up, using the excess momentum to knock the creature's legs out from under it. The gamble worked, and the thing slammed its head into the metal of the vent, stunning it momentarily. I used the temporary break to jump to my feet and call down to Scarlet. "There's a creature up here, hurry!" The vent was taller up here, and I was able to stand with barely a crouch in my stance. It was still dark, but I could make out several forms further back in the vent. "Come on, there's more of them!" I picked the stunned creature up off the ground and slammed its head into the wall before planting a boot in the back of it and sending it sprawling towards the others, then extended a hand to help Scarlet up. "What's going on?" she asked. "Why are they here?" "I don't know, but it can't be good," I replied. "Let's deal with them first and think about it." She nodded and we ran forward into the group. There were 5 of them, including the battered one I dealt with. Scarlet immediately sent a spinning kick at one of them, sending it tumbling to the metal floor. I stepped on it and leapt forward, sending a punch to the throat of a second. I made contact and prepared to duck under the returning swing, but it never came. Instead, it turned to go after Scarlet. Without hesitation, I tackled it, slamming it into a wall, but it didn't make an effort to retaliate, simply struggling against my hold to continue after Scarlet, who was busy bumping 2 of the creatures over the ledge. "They're not going after me," I called to her, the reason why slowly dawning on me. I bent down, picking up the creature and hurling it over my head in the direction of the ledge. It landed hard on the floor, as I wasn't strong enough to clear the ledge, but its momentum carried it the rest of the way. They must sense that the virus is in me. They're completely ignoring me. "Lucky you," Scarlet muttered, as the 2 remaining creatures advanced on her. "Give me a hand with these, would you?" I jumped into action, launching a spinning back fist at one of the ones near me. The blow glanced off of its head, and with little damage done, but it stumbled to the side, and I gave a mighty push as it went off balance, knocking it into the other one. The second one was pushed over the edge, but the first managed to barely keep its balance, teetering on the brink of the abyss. Scarlet finished the job, planting a kick heavily on its chest and watching until it disappeared into the darkness. We quickly began to make our way to the vent we'd make our entrance through, and as we walked, Scarlet said, "Does this mean you're making the transition?" "I don't know," I replied. "If not, I'm probably getting close. We'd better hurry." We ran the rest of the way, and when we made it to the vent, I quickly pried it open and lowered myself through. It struck me immediately. It's odd that the lights were out. It was as dark as it had been on the lower levels. When Scarlet lowered herself down behind me, she noticed the same thing. "This isn't good," she whispered. "You don't think the creatures could have..." How would the virus have gotten up here, I asked, knowing the question she was going to ask, unless the scientists or someone in the lab area. The thought faded, unfinished, into darkness. Let's get this over with, Scarlet said. I began to wish I had some form of communication with her, or anyone, to be honest, but it was impossible with the radio blockage. Before I could think twice about it, though, she was gone, and I was alone in the dark hallway. I touched the wall to get my bearings, and set off for the main office where Jace believed the scientist would be held. I walked quietly, willing to accept the delay to avoid a large delay if someone or something heard me. Everything was empty. There was no sign of life anywhere, nor were there signs of death we'd seen downstairs. It was just empty. I hurried my way through the halls, unwilling to test fate after our experience in the vents, and after some time I arrived at the innermost office, that of Andrew Rhino. The entrance was lavish, consisting of two massive wooden doors, a traditional entryway with very modern security, as what I assumed to be a retinal scanner to the right of the door evident. The doors were at the end of a long hallway, and I had just entered it. Even though the darkness, though, I could tell that something was wrong. It was pretty easy, as they were wide open. That wasn't a good sign for me. I guessed that there had been an outbreak, and as opposed to seeking out the creatures, the survivors had made their last stand in Rhino's office. They evidently hadn't fared terribly well. I cautiously approached the once luxurious office, and as I did so, the feeling of lurking evil within me rose, stronger than it ever had before. It knocked me to my knees, and I felt dizzy as I attempted to suppress it, but I fought hard, making my way to my feet, as I knew there was quite a bit riding on me. As I examined my surroundings, fighting the feeling that my head was spinning, I realized that the office perhaps wasn't the word to describe Rhino's workplace. It seemed like a headquarters in and of itself, as the room I was in looked like a lobby. I could see four hallways branching out from where I stood, which had been on the blueprints, but it was very different now that I was looking at them. All of this just for one man. A mental picture of him was beginning to form, and it wasn't someone I thought I could get along with very well. Regardlessly, I followed Jace's instructions down the middle hallway, which just so happened to be where the multiple trails of blood also led. I was about 10 steps down the hallway when I heard the first clunk. It came from somewhere ahead, and I froze, but nothing followed it. I knew I could do nothing but push on, and hopefully be prepared for whatever arrived. There were several doors on either side of me, but I ignored them all. Not only were they utterly empty, but my goal was in the deepest part of this office. Jace had assumed, apparently correctly, that they would have tried to put as many spaces between themselves and the initial outbreak as possible, and that they would be tucked away in the deepest recesses of the office. When I finally did come across it, unlike the rest of the office, it wasn't very luxurious, just two plain doors. There were several corpses scattered about, but I knew I was running out of time, so I didn't waste any on them. I tried the handle and it was unlocked, but when I pushed the door, it wouldn't budge. I paused for a moment, considering my options, and stepped back, ready to kick it down. However, before I could, one of the doors flung open, revealing a woman in a tattered white lab coat who was pointing a gun at me. "Who the hell are you?" she asked, "and why didn't they attack you?" "What? I'm an FBI agent. I..." Before I could finish my explanation, a massive surge of darkness rose up, nearly bottling out my vision. I once again fell over, but this time I couldn't stand up. "You're infected, aren't you?" she said, brandishing the gun at me. "I don't have the cure. I wish I did, but the formula is incomplete. If I had the cure, Do you think we'd be all here right now? Don't shoot, I groaned, holding a hand up. We have the missing piece, my partner, she's immune, go inside. Get a dose ready, she'll be here any... The virus racked my body and I began to convulse violently, and then my rational brain lost control. I remember vague images from that time. The scientist slammed the door shut. I imagine she barricaded them after. The various flashes of hallways and other creatures as I wandered around the darkened floor. I didn't go too far from where I'd left, and the next thing that happened was Scarlet coming running around the hallway. The creature that I had become joined the crowd that followed her, and she fired several times at us. One of the bullets crippling me on the leg, thankfully incapacitating me, otherwise I might have persisted and something bad could have happened to one of us. The creature crawled for some time but eventually gave up. The next thing I remember was the light turning on. The creatures must have a aversion to light because it felt incredibly painful, and the creature cowered there on the carpet. Then with a jolt, I returned to consciousness. Gah! I shouted, sitting bolted upright, as a sharp pain in my arm brought me back to reality, the events of the day quickly coming back to me. I looked down at my hands to see that the gray was quickly fading, and when I felt my cheeks, the skin was regaining its warmth, smooth feeling. Then I looked around. Scarlet smiled, seeing the color return to my eyes, and said, "It's over. We made it." Thank God, I was getting a little worried there for a minute, I groaned, and she laughed. "What the hell happened?" "They had shut down the power," Scarlet began. "I couldn't activate the elevator, so I decided to come back for you. But when I got here, it was just Dr. Russell. She explained what happened with you. So she took some of my blood, and we had the cure ready. But then there was the matter to finding you, and in the dark with who knows how many other creatures that looked a whole lot like you out there, that would have been easier said than done." So we fought our way to the control room, turned on the power, and while we were at it, we disabled the frequency jammer and radioed for backup, and from there, it was a matter of time before we found you. As circulation returned to my body, I made my way to my feet, with the help of Scarlet. "Alright, so what happened up here? Why are the creatures here, and how did they get in the vents?" "The virus is respiratory, something I tried to explain to Dr. Rhino, but he refused to acknowledge it," Dr. Russell stepped in. "As soon as the first ventilation cycle started, it made its way from down there to up here, and several of them began transforming. I barricaded myself in the inner office with doses of the cure ready. I mean, I really didn't have much else to do other than wait. And that's what I did." "So where is Rhino now?" Scarlet asked. "He's going to have to answer for all of this." "I don't know," Dr. Russell shrugged. "I hadn't seen him since the outbreak up here began, so he most likely got infected and turned into one of these," she said, gesturing to the corpses of either dead or cowering forms on the fluorescent lights. "I suppose it's a fitting end, I must. Destroyed by the very thing he inevitably created." "I guess so," Scarlet nodded. "So how far out is backup?" I asked. "I can't be the only one getting sick of walking on carpeted floors." "They should be getting here any minute," Scarlet replied. "Advanced teams are getting flown in, and it sounds like Clay is with one of them." "Clay, what does she want?" I asked. "Don't let her hear you talking like that. She's still our superior," she warned, "but my guess would be we're in line for a promotion." The thought was comforting, a sensation that almost felt unfamiliar after the past day, and the minutes until they arrived flew by. Helicopters landed on the roof, and agents in hazmat suits entered through a rooftop entrance. Once we explained that we had been cured and that the airborne form of the virus would most likely remain dormant for several more hours until the creatures up here reached maturity. Scarlet helped me up the ladder, and several medics attended to the bullet in my leg. It was such a flurry of activity, agents hurried around and scientists yelling at them to be more careful, but I had been put on some minor painkillers as the medics fixed up my leg, so I was oblivious to most of it. Once things had settled down, Scarlet came over to sit by me. "They're going to burn it to the ground," she said. "They talked to Jace, since it seems like the company is going to him, and he thinks that's the best thing to do. There's no board or anything. Rhino owned the entirety of the company, so it's all up to him." "That's good. He deserves it," I replied. I'd only known him for that day, but if this was how he handled an outbreak of a zombie virus, running a company should be light work for him. "Well, that's mission number one. In the book, I have to say, this is not my definition of routine." "I might check out the benefits we get from that," she mustered. "Early retirement is a serious option for me." I laughed, but quickly regained my composure as a woman approached us. I'd recognized her immediately as Carmen Clay, and when I did my best attempt at snapping to attention, she held up a hand and, "At ease, agent. You've done enough today." "Thank you, ma'am," I replied. "Well, if my ears are correct, I heard the word retirement getting tossed around here," she said. Turning to Scarlet, "I do hope a little mission like that won't be enough to scare off a fantastic pair like you." "I was joking, ma'am," Scarlet replied, "although I would not say no to some time off." Of course," Clay nodded. "In all seriousness, this was an incredibly strenuous, dangerous, and difficult mission. I can name a dozen veterans here that wouldn't be able to handle it, and I want you both to know how proud we all are of your efforts." "Thank you," Scarlet said. "Also, I do want to let you know what the scientists calculated. If you two hadn't contacted us, there was an 80% chance that the virus would have made it out of that building, and from there, a 60% chance that it would have survived the first day. If it survived that first day, it would have become an airborne, and in that scenario, there would be a 3% chance that we would be able to stop it. And the world is in your debt, though they may never know it." My jaw dropped at the numbers. That's bad, ma'am. I'm glad we were able to do our jobs." "So are we all," she replied. "You too. You make an excellent pairing. You remind me a lot of myself and my former partner. I think you're going to have great careers with the Bureau." "Thank you," Scarlet said. "That means a lot, ma'am." "Well, you'd best be leaving now," Clay told us. "I'm giving the both of you paid time off. Go somewhere nice, enjoy yourselves." We assured her we would, and Scarlet helped me into an awaiting helicopter. As we flew off towards the nearby base, the sun was just beginning to rise to the east. To those who have never experienced a sunrise from a helicopter, I must recommend it. It's beautiful. And with that, my first mission with the Supernatural Division of the FBI came to a close. It was my first, but it certainly would not be my last. Hey guys, thank you for listening to today's Creepypasta, and I hope you enjoyed. I do have a podcast called The Murder House Radio Show. Check it out. The link will be in the description below. It is a true crime podcast. But if you did like, comment, subscribe, and share for more. Hit the bell notification when you subscribe and select all to get all notifications whenever I upload. I upload 6 days a week, Monday to Saturday, at least one video a day. Now all the long episodes and the full series of Creepypastas are on all the major podcasting platforms under the name Deadly_Zone_Narrations. There will be a link in the description. Also, go follow all the social media accounts that are in the description below. I do have a subreddit called Deadly Narrations, link in the description. Also in the description below are all the sources to the Creepypasta and the music used. So go check those out. Let me know what creepypasta you would like to hear next, or if you have your own creepypasta you'd like me to narrate, or if you have a creepypasta series you would like to hear. Send them to me on any of the social medias, in the DMs, or to my email address, which is in the description below. Or leave them in the comments below. Also in the description below is the author's social medias, if they have any listed. But that's it for today's creepypasta. I hope you enjoyed. Until next time in the Deadly Zone, stay deadly and stay spooky.